a lot of these oscillator circuits use capacitors, and there's an important point I'd like to make in this video about the use of a capacitor in an oscillator. In order to make this point, I'd like to step back and look at one-pole filters again. Let's start off with a low-pass filter. The transfer function of a low-pass filter can be found by voltage division. If we simplify this expression by multiplying every term by j omega c, we arrive at a very simple expression for the transfer function, 1 over j omega rc plus 1. Now, this fraction is a complex number. It can be expressed as a magnitude and a phase. Let's go ahead and graph the magnitude and the phase of this particular transfer function. From the magnitude plot, we can clearly see that this is indeed a low-pass filter, because at low frequencies, the transfer function is 1. But at high frequencies, the transfer function goes to 0. The signal can't make it through the filter at high frequencies. But what happens to the phase? Perhaps earlier on in this course, we didn't pay too much attention to the phase, but it turns out that that can be very important for oscillators. At low frequencies, the phase shift is 0 degrees. That's what we expect in a low-pass filter. The phase of the signal should not be altered when it passes through the filter. But at high frequencies, the phase approaches, but never quite reaches, negative 90 degrees. What we can conclude from this particular graph is that a capacitor in the shunt configuration can shift the phase of a signal somewhere between 0 and negative 90 degrees non-inclusive. Let's now look at the circuit of a one-pole high-pass filter. It's the same as a low-pass filter, except that the capacitor and resistor positions have been swapped. Again, the transfer function can be found by voltage division, and if we multiply every term in this expression by j omega c, we can end up with a neat form of the transfer function. We have an imaginary number in the numerator and a complex number in the denominator. Again, because taken as a whole, this is a complex number, we can plot the magnitude and the phase separately. If we plot the magnitude, we are reminded that this is indeed a high-pass filter because the high frequencies are getting through when the magnitude approaches 1, and at low frequencies, the magnitude of the transfer function approaches 0. But what happens to the phase? At high frequencies, the phase approaches 0 degrees. It means that the phase of a high-frequency signal will not be altered as it passes through the high-pass filter. That's what we expect. We don't expect the signal to be altered. But for low-frequency signals, the phase approaches positive 90 degrees. This means that a single capacitor in the series configuration can shift the phase of a signal somewhere between 0 and positive 90 degrees. The point that I'm getting at by looking at these two very simple examples is not only to give us a review, but also to consider that a single capacitor in either the shunt or the series configuration can never shift the phase of a signal by more than 90 degrees. For example, if we wanted to shift the phase of a signal by 180 degrees, in other words, to invert it, there's no hope if we only want to use a single capacitor. Let's now look back at the Wien-Bridge oscillator and see what happens to the phase of the signal as it goes around the feedback loop. The Wien-Bridge oscillator can be neatly divided into an amplifier portion and a filter portion. This is a non-inverting amplifier, so the phase does not change when the signal passes through it. Let me just mark that as 0 degrees. When the signal exits the amplifier and passes through the first capacitor, which is in series, it looks something like a high-pass filter. That means that the signal can be shifted in phase in the positive direction, somewhere between 0 degrees and 90 degrees. The second capacitor is in the shunt configuration. This capacitor will give us a negative phase shift. What's important in the oscillator is that the signal reproduce itself every time it goes around in the loop. For that to happen, you have to have a net phase shift of 0 degrees, or equivalently 360 degrees. The Wien-Bridge oscillator achieves this by having two capacitors, one capacitor to shift the phase forward, and another capacitor to shift the phase backwards. Let's now look at another type of oscillator. The phase shift oscillator has a feedback network and an amplifier, just like the Wien-Bridge oscillator. Unlike the Wien-Bridge oscillator, though, the amplifier for a phase shift oscillator is inverting. That means that it shifts the phase of the signal by 180 degrees. If you look at the filter portion of the phase shift oscillator, you see three capacitors all in series. It first looks like it could be a high-pass filter, and you might wonder, how could this possibly be a high-pass filter and still work? Doesn't an oscillator need to have a bandpass filter to work? In this situation, we actually have a bandpass filter, even though the feedback network looks like a high-pass filter. The reason is because this 180-degree phase shift offered by the amplifier converts the high-pass filter into a bandpass filter effectively. Equivalently, we have three capacitors all in the series configuration. All three of these capacitors can shift the phase of a signal forward somewhere between 0 and 90 degrees. How much phase shift the signal receives depends on the frequency of the particular signal. For low frequencies, the phase shift will be closer to 90 degrees, and for high frequencies, the phase shift will be closer to 0. But what I want you to notice is that for one particular frequency, it will receive a net phase shift in this loop of 360 degrees. And it's only going to work for one frequency, because for any other frequency, when you add up the net phase shift, you're going to get some other number. If we were to hypothetically replace that inverting amplifier with a non-inverting amplifier, this phase shift oscillator would not work. And the reason it wouldn't work is because the signal passing through three capacitors in series would never be able to achieve a net phase shift of 360 degrees. No matter what frequency we have running in that loop. It's possible to achieve 180 degree phase shift at one very special frequency though, and that's why the phase shift oscillator works. Let's go ahead and outline the derivation of that frequency for the phase shift oscillator. If we assume that this amplifier is ideal, we can represent it as a controlled source with a gain of A. A times V3 is the output of that amplifier. That's V0. We know the gain of this amplifier. It's just minus R1 over R. And you'll notice that we have three resistors in this circuit with the same value and three capacitors in this circuit also with the same value. The input impedance to this amplifier is just R. We have 0 volts at the non-inverting pin, and as long as the circuit is stable, we should also have 0 volts there at the inverting pin too. What you're seeing now is an unwrapped version of the same circuit. Let's use voltage gain to find the transfer function of the filter. So we'll start with voltages V3 and V2. Let's continue with V2 and V1. The two branches that I've circled in red are in parallel with one another. Capacitor C is the series element. Finally, let's look at voltages V1 and V0. The two branches that I've circled in purple are in parallel with one another, and I know the expression for the rightmost purple branch already. The series branch in this case is the third capacitor. We can now proceed with steady state analysis just like we did with the Wien bridge oscillator. Let's multiply together the gain of the amplifier with the transfer function of the filter. This is the transfer function of the filter. This is the gain of the amplifier. If we multiply together these three expressions, we'll end up with another expression that is a function only of R, C, and omega. It's going to be a complex number. It takes quite a lot of effort to reach the final solution, and the way I've solved it is to use a computer algebra program. In this case, I use Mathematica in order to simplify the expression. This expression describes the feedback network. The gain of the amplifier, we already know. I've used black for the real numbers, and I've used red for the imaginary numbers in this final expression. We know that this expression has to equal 1 because of cancellation on the left side of the equation. If all of these terms cancel out, they have to equal 1. Because we have an imaginary number in the numerator, we have to have an imaginary number in the denominator over here as well. Therefore, these two real numbers have to add up to 0. We've now determined the frequency at which the phase shift oscillator will work. This is that very special frequency where the phase shift through the three capacitors will be exactly 180 degrees. Let's simplify the imaginary parts. Let's cancel out the J and one of the omegas from this expression. For omega, we can substitute in the frequency of oscillation. We've just calculated that the gain of the inverting amplifier in the phase shift oscillator has to be negative 29 in order for the signal to sustain itself as it goes around in the loop. But if we were to actually build that circuit, we would want to design it so that the magnitude of the nominal gain in the circuit would be higher than 29. That would help account for any losses in the circuit and also to ensure that the signal can build up from noise.